Give it up for Karen Clark Shea, please.
Good evening and God bless everyone. I am Elder Michael Payton, one of the vice presidents for the International Sunday School Department, and we are so excited that you have joined us on this wonderful, wonderful Saturday. Nope, on this wonderful Sunday evening to discuss the responsive reading for the Church of God in Christ Sunday School Department and some other Sunday school stuff. We will be joined on tonight by our absolutely fantastic international president, the one and only Dr. Mark Ellis, along with a Sunday school legend. His name is Dr. Rodney Atkins, one of the vice presidents and maybe the longest serving vice president in AIM. He is such a legend, and he is already with us backstage, and we are going to have a conversation about just some Sunday school stuff, in particular, our new responsive reading for the Church of God in Christ Sunday School. We honor you wherever you may be watching from. Will you help us on tonight by liking, sharing, commenting? If you will, tell us how today went as you were going through the new responsive reading that launched with this first Sunday in September. Continue to put into the chat where you are watching from. If you got a wonderful Sunday school teacher, go ahead and put that also in the chat. Give a shout out to your Sunday school teacher and say, yep, my Sunday school teacher is the bomb. We are grateful for all of the teachers, the pastors, for the students, secretaries, for all of those who are involved in this assignment, this mission, if you will. As our president often says, to eradicate biblical illiteracy. That is our responsibility, and we take this assignment seriously. Yes, we do. We take this assignment seriously. We have with us the legend, if you will. I'm going to pull out our wonderful Vice President, Dr. Rodney Atkins, to say hello to everyone. Listen, if you are in Sunday school anywhere in the Church of God in Christ, you have seen this man and seen this face, whether it was in the convocation or AIM. This man has sacrificed so much for Sunday schools around the country. He was recently honored by Chairman Dillard and the AIM department. We honor you, sir, for being a legend. Will you say hello to everyone on tonight and have greetings?
Good evening to the saints. I'm just so excited to be. I'm so excited to be with you all tonight. Can you hear me?
Hear you well, sir. Yes, sir.
We thank God for this opportunity to serve in this department. I have full passion for this department. On the presentation that was given to me in AIM, I did not want too many people to know that I've been here longer than the tenure of Bishop Macklin and Bishop Gatlin and Dr. Ellis. I was one of the youngest jurisdictional state Sunday school superintendents when I came into the department. Yes, I actually was there during the era of Bishop Williams.
Wow.
And so I still have the same love for the Sunday school department. And my role tonight is my profession. Besides being a pastor, administrative assistant.
Come on, sir.
By profession, I'm a librarian. And all four of my earned degrees have spent in doing research. And so tonight I'm prepared to give research information. I can tell you when the first responsive reading.
Come on, sir.
Put together. I can explain how we went into having the quarterlies. I can straighten out some misinformation we have. And so tonight I'm ready to get started as soon as I'm given the chance. Thank you.
We are so honored to have you to join us, sir. Everybody needs a historian on the team. Everybody needs to know, forgive me for using this mafia term, but I watched The Irishman on yesterday. Everybody needs to know somebody who know where the bodies are buried. Yeah, that's a term just to show you got to have somebody with wisdom and experience, with knowledge, with history, and that is Dr. Rodney Atkins. You are such a huge part of this team, sir, and we honor you for all that you do in Sunday school. Ladies and gentlemen, we are so excited to have with us on tonight the man behind the revolution that is taking place in Sunday school. Dr. Mark Ellis is the pastor of the United Christian Faith Ministries in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He is the husband of one wife, an outstanding father, but all of that is wonderful and great, and it is fantastic, but he's saved, sanctified, and he's filled with the Holy Ghost, and he loves Sunday school. And our president has joined us from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He is the brainchild behind what you see going on in the Sunday school department. President, if you will, greet everyone, and we're following your lead, sir, as we get rolling on tonight.
Thank you, and good evening, everybody. And to our host tonight, our pastor, I'm calling you pastor, but Elder Michael Payton, thank you for your leadership and learning and development for this great department. And Superintendent Atkins, what can we say about our historian, pioneer, and thank God that Bishop Shear had the visionary leadership to see that we needed a leader such as Superintendent Atkins, and of course our own mother supervisor, Mother Penix, and her leadership role, and just for grounding and all of our passion about Sunday school. We need the prayers, we need the coverings of leaders such as Superintendent Rodney Atkins. And so, my brother, thank God for you. I love you, man of God. Glad you're here tonight. And to everybody that's chiming in, this is an exciting time. I mean, we get to dispel some myths, and we get to bring clarity to what God is saying to the church in this hour, and explain how we plan to leverage the scripture in this new, well-thought-out, prayed-for arrangement that we call the responsive reading, to drive to growth, to drive to Christian conduct and behavior that expands the kingdom of God. And so I hope, again, the men and women of God are liking and sharing, and again, open to all that God will say through all of the leaders who will share on tonight. But I'm glad to be here. And again, I'm excited about this time in the kingdom and what God is doing in Sunday schools around the world. God bless you, and let's get into it.
Awesome. We start all of our training and all of our development, anything that deals with curriculum, instruction, workshop, streaming, whatever it is, in the International Sunday School Department, with our core values. We love to remind the people, as the foundation of all that we do, there's a systematic approach, there's a reason, there's a mission, right? There's a purpose, there's an intentionality to all that we do. And the core values of our Sunday school department came directly from our president. So I'm going to toss it back to him to take a minute or two to discuss, why are these six values so important? Reaching, teaching, ministering, assimilating, building, and involving people. President.
Absolutely. Thank you. You know, core values are nothing new to any organization, whether it is a corporation, a nonprofit, a church, a home. Core values. Values are the non-negotiables in life, right? It is what you decide on as it relates to how you want to build out the quality of the life of your family, your business, your ministry. A man or woman should never decide to be successful, but rather decide what their core values are and let their core values drive their success. Now, that's actually an Albert Einstein quote, that a man or woman should never decide success apart from your core values. Imagine if we were rooted and grounded in what we decide, or what we say our core values are. You would see less corruption in business, less manipulation, less falls, if you would, moral failures, economic failures. You would see a government functioning better. You would see a church functioning better, a business functioning better. And where you do see organizations committed to core values, you see systemic and sustainable success. So we arrived at these core values through research, through looking at what the Word of God says concerning what the body of Christ is to do, making disciples. So in order to make a disciple, you got to first reach people. We reach to touch, we preach to save, but we teach to change. Reaching people, the first core value. And then you go from reaching people to teaching people, right? People have to be taught. So we say in school on Sunday or Sunday school that you're not a legitimate church unless you have a school. Thus, Sunday school. The mission of the church is to make disciples. So teaching people, extrapolating from scripture so people can appreciate what God is saying. And that's a special gift that God has given to the body. Explaining, clarifying, giving application, and asking for commitment, teaching. Ministering to people. The word ministry has to do with finding needs and meeting it. If you say you are a minister, that is above and beyond preaching the gospel. Ministering to people is what? Finding a need and meeting it. And of course, no greater need in a human being's life than what? The word of God. The Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So Sunday school's core value is what? Ministering to people. So we teach the word of God so the disciple can then leave our classroom and go do what? Minister to people. Mm-hmm. The husband goes home and ministers to the wife. The wife goes home and ministers to the husband. The mother goes home and ministers to the children. The children go home and what? Minister back to their siblings and to their parents in some way. And then it spreads out into school and into the marketplace. Number four, we value involving people. Involving people. People are created by God with a shape and a design. God will use you only how he has designed you. Now, man will use you wherever he needs you. And sometimes that can lead to abuse. So in school on Sunday, we involve people around their shape and around their spiritual gift, how God has designed them. This cuts down and what? Limits the abuse that could take place in church, in homes, in the marketplace. When people understand their spiritual gift, the heart that God has given them, their what? Their abilities, their personality, their experiences, and bring it all together. They know then how to what? Fit in as a piece to a puzzle in God's master puzzle. They know how to fit in and find their contribution. We value, number five, assimilating people. Mm-hmm. Assimilating people into what? The culture of the church, assimilating people into what? The organization, the organism, into ministry. And then finally, we value building relationships. Sunday school ought to be relational, right? It's a community of vulnerability. We don't just come and study the word of God. We do life together, building relationships. So that involves a level of emotional intelligence. We can't be stuck up off to ourselves, mm-hmm. indifferent. We work to resolve relationships. Blessed are the peacemakers, right? We're called to show mercy. That's how we build relationships. Not based upon just commonality and shared purpose. No, we build relationships based upon our experiences, what we've been through, and then going out and having that empathy and that compassion for other people. Sunday school students and leaders know no stranger because we're called to the value of building relationships with people. Mm-hmm. Our six core values.
Excellent. Awesome. So when you all see all of our core values, understand that is what's driving the programs, the systems, the ideas, the classes. And then we also want to continue to share it for you to challenge us. If you see there's something coming, from the International Sunday School, and it does not fit one of those core values. We ask that you keep us aligned to our purpose.
Right.
I was a little late for Sunday school on this morning, and it was Pastor Ellis's fault because I'm watching his 8 o'clock class preaching on today. And he said, if we're not walking in purpose, then we'll stay subject to our predicament.
Yeah.
Our purpose is built around our core values. And we thank you, sir, for laying that foundation for us. Dr. Atkins, if you will, when you look at our core values, how do they compare to the original purpose of Sunday school? With you being the historian and you being knowledgeable of the development and the purpose of Sunday school, are we aligned with the original purpose as you look at the core values of reaching, assimilating? Are we still in line with the original intent of what Sunday school was supposed to be?
Most certainly, reaching people, teaching people, ministering to people, involving people, assimilating people, building relationships. Sunday school is the forefront of Christian education, and it's done by training, developing, and equipping the saints for the work of ministry. So all six are a part of the history of this great department.
Awesome. Thank you, sir. So now we are at September the 3rd, and today was the magnificent launch of a new responsive reading for the Church of God in Christ, a revised responsive reading. President, will you give us the motive, the drive, purpose? How does the new responsive reading, let's just talk first about the development. The mindset, what was the attitude in your meditation as the Lord began to download to you all that you shared with us in the production of this revised responsive reading? What was the thoughts that the Lord shared with you as for its purpose, if you will?
Thank you. Well, you know, when I came into this role, we were in the middle of a pandemic. And so we had time to do research, to evaluate what is the state of school on Sunday schools now. Looking at data from the publishing house, curriculum, and the order of curriculum that was declining, the doors of the church that was closing, some were coming back to have service, but they were not coming back to have school on Sunday. I looked at the infrastructure of some of our churches, many of our churches, where there was just a lack of passion. So when the pandemic hit and there was so much uncertainty, it appeared that the passion for school on Sunday was lost as well. Not all, but many were not making that differential investment to get their schools back up and running. We were preaching, but not many were teaching. And so I then began to look at, how do you drive to a new behavior, a new culture? You got to go to the Word of God. What I love about the responsive reading, even the old and the new, both are in the scripture. So for those who are alarmed that we are moving the old landmark, we're not moving the old landmark. We're still in the Word of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So I looked at every important discipline that was in Sunday school. And many of you, our team, we vetted these ideas. I didn't just create this in a bubble. Of course, we looked at the purpose of a responsive reading. Check this out. The purpose of a responsive reading is to support students in achieving the curricular outcomes. What are the outcomes of our school on Sunday? You know, sometime in church, we can create a school that never turns its students out to go and be involved and active in producing outcomes. We're forever learning, but never coming into the knowledge of transforming our cities and our communities for the glory of God. Back to the responsive reading. Its purpose is to inspire students to become engaged in comprehension, but also the practice of scripture commands. Mm-hmm. So I began to look at our responsive reading as it is today. And of course, I love it. The old one, I memorized it. I knew it by heart. I've been teaching Sunday school ever since I was in the sixth grade in my father's church. I was actually teaching the adult, the high school class in the sixth grade. That's how much I had an affinity for scripture. I didn't know it all, but my father trusted me enough to study as an 11-year-old to teach my older brother and sister, 15 and 16, in the high school class. Go figure that out.
Wow.
But God graced me to do it. The purpose. Then its value. What is the value of responsive reading? And for those who may object to the change in the arrangement of scripture, because that's what it is, understand its core value to the organization. It has to be biblical, historical, but not just biblical and historical. It has to be participatory, but also instructional. Does it drive to a new discipline? And based upon where we were at hemorrhaging in Sunday school, right? Sunday school's declining, curriculum is declining, the purchase of curriculum declining. People are not involved in the word of God. Biblical illiteracy is going up. The Barna group said less and less people are what? Are praying. And if they are praying, they're not praying the scripture. We had to make a clarion call to the students. We had to say, we need a new response from you in light of all that's going on in the world, the uncertainty of the pandemic, the biblical illiteracy rates going up. Are you with me? Divorce rate going up, opioid addiction going up, young African-American males are dropping out of school, incarceration rates are going up, dope addiction is going, I could just go on and on statistically. There must be a new call and response. Thus, a new responsive reading. Let's have a call to attention. And so we start off with, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. But then we come in and challenge you, but to do good and to communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. That means even in a pandemic, we got to be working to do good and to communicate. We can't forget. Schools don't have an option to open. Just like in the secular, they were driving to get those schools back open. We needed that same passion in Sunday school to get our schools back open. Schools are back open. Universities are back open in America. But yet today, some churches have not opened their Sunday school. I come again, but to do good and to communicate. Forget not, for which such sacrifices God is well pleased. I'll pause it there. Say loud.
Wow. Dr. Atkins, one more time, if you will. Behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Before we go to our next few verses of the responsive reading, give us a bit of history, if you will, on the intent so that we can show it matches exactly the vision that our president has. Give us the history of the responsive reading.
Well, I hope everyone caught what he explained consisting of the responsive reading. He said biblical, historical, participatory, and instructional for the life of the church. So in 1967, under Bishop C.W. Williams.
Yes, sir.
He was the president from 1967 to 1992. So this was the beginning of the responsive reading. And so what we are doing in our department now, the value of it is there. It's biblical. It's historical. It is participatory. And it's instructional for the life of the church.
Thank you, sir. That is awesome. While you are at home watching, this is Sunday school and we're supposed to be interactive. Sunday school should not be a lecture. We should be participatory. Right. That's what we were just told by our president and our vice president. So here's what you are going to do while you are at home and you are watching. You are going to take a look at President Stop with the first two responsive readings. We want you at home to put into the chat, how do you see this scripture fitting the core values? If our scripture says, behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, remember, we should be driven by our core values.
Right.
So if you are watching at home, go ahead and put into the chat, where do you see this first scripture? We know you can't see us, but you can hear us. You can see your screen. Behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Which one of the core values? Dr. Atkins, I'm going to put you on the spot because you are a college professor. So this is nothing for you. Which one of the responsive readings would you say our first scripture, behold how good and pleasant, Psalm 133 and 1, which one of our core values would you say it matches?
Involving people?
Certainly. Unity. Mm-hmm. Would you say another one?
Assimilating people.
They're lighting up the chat with some of your same answers, inviting, reaching. President, would you like to chime in on that connection?
Absolutely. I mean, ideally, when we were putting this together, and if you guys remember, we were kind of vetting, ensuring that they align, but it touches a little of all of them.
Yes, sir.
Right? It depends on where you at in your discipleship efforts of discipling other people, but definitely it involves reaching people. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together, right, in unity. So it lets you know that this is something that's near and dear to God's heart, that God is obsessed with oneness, that we come together. So in order to come together, we got to what? We got to reach people.
Yes.
We got to touch people. That means sometimes even our own members in our congregation, we have allowed to slip through the cracks, become spiritually indifferent, or the old terminology is what? Backsliding. And we don't have assimilating or reaching ministry, follow-up and retrievals, what we call it in our church, to go after those who seemingly have become slack in their worship to God. Mm-hmm. And so Sunday school on Sunday hasn't had an element or an arm that is staying in contact with not just those who have enrolled in Sunday school, but with the entire congregation.
Wow.
At my church, we tell all of our members, you may not come to Sunday school every Sunday, but reading is not optional. Everybody needs a Sunday school book in their library.
Whether they come or not.
Whether you come or not. 12 to 13 expository lessons should be in your library every quarter. Purchase a $3 Sunday school book to all of our adults. That's the challenge.
Absolutely. We love it. President Red the Second, but to do good and to communicate, forget not. Please do the same at home. We're not going to do this with each one. And because the Sunday school absolutely loves you, we're going to show you how you can get these slides, but you're going to have to like our social media pages. If you like our pages, we will prepare and show you how you can get these slides and share them at your local church. Go ahead in the chat, but to do good and to communicate, forget not. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. Yep, reading is not an option. This is certainly Sister McBride ministering to people, involving and assimilating people. What we're trying to show you, that this did not come like pulling a rabbit out of a hat. This was through meditation, through prayer, and through collaboration, these scriptures matching our core values that drives everything that we do. I see somebody said, that they're taking screenshots. Oh, we got you. We thank God for this team that our president has put together, and we're going to make sure that you have it. Here's one our president stopped that, and we're going to give him a chance to speak on it. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and if profitable and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for right instruction in righteousness. 2 Timothy 3 and 16. President, talk on this scripture, if you will, sir.
Definitely. When it talks about, you know, the prior scripture that says, don't fail not to do good, or in so many words, do good and communicate, forget not. Imagine if we leverage that in our churches, and we had focus group and think tanks where people began to look at the crisis of America, the crisis of certain demographics. How can we do good? How can we let our light shine in this space? People are living in fear. People are living in poverty. People are living in pain. Imagine, again, the responsive reading is not just for scriptural comprehension, but for what? The practice of the command. So now it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. This is the usability of scripture. This is what we use. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. The functionality of the scripture. Use it to transform the community. Use it to transform human lives. Use the scriptures to liberate the human soul. So that's the charge of the superintendent, informing the believer, the students, the teachers of the comprehension of the scripture, how powerful it is. It's our weapon of choice. It's what we use, the washing of water by the word of God. The scripture, the superintendent is to put what? A heightened elevation to increase the deference or the reverence and the honor given to what? To scripture. And now the student responds.
Come on, sir.
The student, look at the student's response. The word is a lamp unto my feet. Superintendent, you just told me that it's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. And now I'm responding. The student says, this is the word we want them to hide in their heart. The word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my pathway. That means when I get lost and I'm at a dead end, or the way I'm going seems dark, I go back to the word of God. When life doesn't seem to be working out the way, again, the plan, the vision that I say I have concerning the things of God for my life, I go back to the word of God. I get back in Sunday school. I get back under good teaching. That's what we want in the student's heart. So they become studious. They see the value of the word of God. It's not just used for intellectual stimulation. Yes, it is used for lifestyle transformation. Lamp unto my feet, that implies I'm going somewhere, and a light unto my path. That means I have a plan. I have a destination, a destiny. Hallelujah. That's what we want in the heart. So people have this affinity for school on Sunday. They can't miss it.
Wow.
Imagine that, especially in our communities, communities of color, marginalized communities, people that have been left out and left off, people who have always been taught to look to government for a handout, to look for somebody else to give you direction. Imagine going back to the word of God and discovering the wisdom that God gave Solomon. Hallelujah.
So then the superintendent says, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Philippians 2 and 4. What I love personally, and I'm only the host, but what I love about the responsive reading is how they all connect. It almost flows like a prescription on what to do to get healing, deliverance, recovery.
Right.
The superintendent responds. The student said, gives his response. So now the superintendent reminds us that whatever it is God has given to us, it really don't belong to us. It really is given to us to share, to give. Remember the Old Testament, the principle of Jubilee, the principle of sacrifice, taking care of the widow or the orphan, or sharing with your neighbor. Can you all see post-pandemic how these scriptures, not only should guide our response in Sunday school, but you really could take these slides and give to missions, to evangelism. Right. This could be a whole church approach to building the community, to reaching out. President, Dr. Atkins, if you will, chime in.
I want to say this. Dr. Ellis, you remind me of Bishop Lawrence Patrick, who served from 1944 to 1967.
Praise God.
I want you to be mindful of what he said in one segment. He said, the architect of time. 13 years ago, the architect of time unfolded to me this space in my life.
Wow.
That is being used in the development of our Sunday school department. And my desire is that I will be able to complete my task according to the blueprint that has been designed by the great architect of time.
Hallelujah.
In another writing, he says, bear in mind that it's not enough for one to be able to look into the future, but in order to bring it to pass, there must be certain hand-in-hand cooperation given.
Come on.
We today are representing the strongest or the farthest reaching department of our church, right, the Sunday school. Yes. In view of the fact that it is the only department that covers the church in its entirety, and that both male and female alike share equal in the task of labor. I know that you will agree with me that whenever children are involved, the interest and responsibility of that church or nation becomes greater.
My God.
Hallelujah.
That is so powerful. I think we're going to get in trouble right here. You all knew when you asked me to be the host that there would be some trouble along the way. So this shouldn't be surprising. I believe that Professor L.C. Patrick also was responsible for music. Is that correct, Dr. Atkins?
Yes, it was through the Sunday school department that they introduced the concept of a music division. And he was the one recommended and set it up in the convocation.
So I'll let the president take it from there, so I won't get in too much trouble, because now we done told the people that the music department came out of Sunday school. Mr. Yes, president.
Sir. And in all actuality, again, that's the history. And I, again, want to thank our historian, the great Dr. Rodney Atkins, for his labor of gathering these facts and doing the research. Again, I know that to be true, that the International Music Department was birthed out of the Sunday School Department, and rightfully so. Those who are given to the scripture, an affinity for God's word, are always singing, are given to song, the exaltation of God. Consider the power of the word of God. It provokes singing. Come into his presence with singing.
Come on, sir.
Right? It's almost impossible to have a heart for God and not want to sing. Not want to sing. That's why I believe, even in the International Sunday School Department, we must have an arm for singing.
Yeah.
Writing new songs from the scripture.
Yes.
Songs that remind people of the authority of God's word. Hallelujah. That we'll wash through the water of the word of God.
Yes.
Imagine doing that with melodies from our heart. We have an incredible opportunity with school on Sunday to change the world on Monday. And God has yet placed that burden, that demand on the Sunday school department of churches.
Yes.
To transform. It's great to preach. The exhortation gift, preaching, has an incredible influence on the body of Christ. But you dismantle strongholds. You unhook people from the chains of deception, ignorance, and darkness through the teaching anointing, through the teaching gift. The Bible says when Jesus came into Jerusalem, he was moved with compassion because he saw Israel as sheep without a shepherd.
Yeah.
And the Bible says he then began to teach them. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. The teaching anointing. I know in Luke, he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and he has anointed me to preach. But when he saw the human depravity, the teacher anointing rose up in him. Mm-hmm. And he sat down and taught them. And so it is, we are making a clarion call for teachers. Wow. Even through the responsive reading, when we challenge you to look not upon the things of yourself, but upon the things of others,
mm-hmm.
right? Not upon your own interests, but every man on the things of others. This could be something as simple as if you're in Sunday school and you know there are mothers, single mothers with children, they can't get up in time to fix breakfast. You go in your pantry, you make some sandwiches and say free breakfast on Sunday morning. To get kids in Sunday school. Or you take courage and you go out to a store, a McDonald's, and say, listen, I'm asking for some free sausage biscuits. Yes, I'm teaching school to hungry kids on Sunday morning. And these kids need to be taught the word of God so they can be more impactful in the classroom on Monday. They can be better laborers and part-time workers in the marketplace on Monday. We need some support. The Bible says we have not because we ask not. Yes. Glory to God. Are you with me? Looking at what could be keeping people from the word of God, and let's close the gap. Something as simple as that. Seeing the needs in the church. Somebody may be underserved without proper attire. And we put on a clothing drive. School on Sunday is sponsoring shoes for work and school on Monday. Come on, brothers and sisters. We're asking God for wealth, but I think sometimes we're not connected to the vision and the mission of the church. Mm-hmm. And all money has to be on a mission. Glory to God. There's no shortage in the kingdom of God. You can ask what you will when you're connected to Sunday school. And I speak prophetically tonight. Those who will get involved with Sunday school will know no lack. You build an incredible Sunday school department and your church will be debt free. There will be no building large enough to hold the people in your community, whether you're in a rural Puckerbrush, Timbuktu city, or you're in a metropolitan area. Build the school on Sunday and just watch the teacher anointing begin to fill the pew. People are hungry for the living word. Hallelujah. And they want to be taught.
Yeah.
They want their questions answered. Let's go.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, the music department came out of Sunday school. Yes, choir members should be in Sunday school.
Come on now.
And not just coming when it's time to sing.
Right.
We stand firmly in that. If you have any complaints or criticism, email me at mellis@kojic.org. The next slide.
Let's say something. Let me go back and say something about that singing since you brought it up.
Come on, sir.
Imagine trying to sing about God and you don't know scripture.
Come on,
this
sir.
Is how we get introduced into our libraries of gospel music, songs that don't align with the scripture, because we have writers who don't know the scripture. We got psalmists who don't go to Sunday school. So you can't even exhort properly. You get into prophesying when you don't know sound doctrine. Mm-hmm. You will lie on God, lie for God, because you're simply in a state of ignorance. We're all born in the state of ignorance. Some of us never move. I submit to you spiritually, you never move out of the state of ignorance until you go to Sunday school.
Jesus, wow. All right. You heard it from the president, the prophetic word that if you build your Sunday school.
Hallelujah.
Next slide. He that have a bountiful eye shall be blessed. Go back in the chat, those of you that are watching. How does this compare to our core values? He that have a bountiful eye shall be blessed, for he giveth of his bread to the poor. Proverbs 22 and 9. That is a student response. We are responding. We are reaching people. We are reaching people. Yes, this is no more just sitting in the sanctuary and impressing one another. The word demands a response. President Dr. Atkins, he that have a bountiful eye shall be blessed. Speak on it.
Yes, I was really thinking about from a historical view. You know, I'm the historian.
That's it.
So I noticed that it's showing children. Now I'm moving over into the youth department right now. Okay. Let me give the history real quick. Elder D.J. Young was the first publisher of the Church of God in Christ, and he supplied the need with Sunday school literature whereby all schools could study the same lessons, or in other words, a uniform lesson for all Sunday schools of the Church of God in Christ. It was indeed a great need that he supplied, for up to this time, the youth was not included.
Wow.
I'm going to say that again. Up to this point, the youth were not included. And so there was a need that he supplied, and it was a realization that it was Elder Young's dreams, because he had pleaded for years that the children could have cards and Sunday school literature. So back in 1916, the concept of working with even youth came from the Sunday school department.
Wow.
That's history. And as much as the revisionists are trying to change history, you cannot change what has already happened. The next one. Wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. When we first looked at this revision, I actually mentioned to President, how does this one fit in with all of the others? Mr. President, will you address Ephesians 4 and 8?
This is involving people. That means the involvement of people was God's idea. God's idea. He gave gifts to men. That means when you're born again, every born again believer has a gift. For what? Involvement. Involvement. Not for performance, not to benefit you. No tree eats its own fruit. It's for the benefit of others. Sunday school is to provoke one another unto what? Good works. The works of Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is God at work in us, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Through what? His gifts. So the superintendent is letting us know that God has given us gifts. And this is the core value of involving people. God has given us gifts for what? Getting involved. No one is just a volunteer in the army of the Lord. Because the last time I checked, no army has volunteers. All armies have recruits, soldiers. All soldiers have a mode of operation.
Yes, sir.
All soldiers have a specialization. Come on now. Mm-hmm. That's in the natural army. It's no different in God's army. One body, but many members. And all of these members have some specialization. So we involve people around what? God's design of them. The Bible says, know no man after the flesh, but rather what? After the spirit. I should know you by your spiritual design, not just by your personality, not just by your euphemism, not just by your passion, but your purpose. Involving people. So when you come to Sunday school, all teachers have to what? not just teach a lesson, not just give instruction, but monitor comprehension. Are these gifts from God comprehending the scripture and finding its application for proper use? So we pray over our students, hallelujah, that they find full application of the scripture according to their design. There are little prophets in our classroom, little teachers, little evangelists, those with the gifts of helps and administration, gifts of miracles. I could go on and on, motivational gifts, manifestation gifts. And so when we finish teaching our lessons, we are praying that the gifts be stirred. So that becomes a what? A return on the word of God.
Which leads us right to the next one. All right. Uh-huh. As every man have received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. 1 Peter 4:10. Again, put your response in the chat. And also, do you see the flow? Let's pause right there because we did have a couple of questions in the chat and our president wanted this to be interactive. He wanted this to be where you had an opportunity to even, dare I say, disagree or share your opinion on the shift. And there was an excellent question earlier in the chat, President. And the question said, how did or are we stating that the previous responsive reading did not meet the needs of the church? Explain how the previous responsive reading did not meet the needs of the church. That was in the chat. Will you respond to it?
Well, the authority of the scripture has tremendous value, whatever litany or arrangement that you place it in. You have to look intently into the scripture. However, when we looked at the six core values, we went back to the scripture to see if there was an even more immediate command of the scripture through the apostles' writings that could speak to addressing the current needs of the time. So no doubt that responsive reading put together over 60 plus years ago spoke to the immediate need of the time. But just like you don't preach the same sermon the same way every single Sunday, every single year, every single convocation, come on somebody, you don't necessarily use the same scripture to address every need, every demand, every crisis. You find where God has spoken with authority to the situation and you bring it to align with what is the demand. And this is where visionary leadership comes in at. This is why when we were putting this together, we had to seek the counsel of not only our presiding bishop, Bishop Jack Whitehead, another historian who was given the task for all oversight when it comes to the Education Commission. And he and I went back and forth for at least 2 days reviewing, understanding the time and the purpose of a responsive reading. How would these scriptures speak to, this is important, does scripture in responsive reading build identity around the core values? And does it build the students' belief in themselves and in the mission of the church? That is the action that must be taken from a responsive reading. Builds identity around the core values. And does it build student belief in themselves and their mission in the church? And so when we looked at that, Bishop Whitehead, the late Bishop Whitehead, God rest his soul, agreed with the arrangements. And he said to us, Ellis, you and that team were called for this assignment in the midst of a pandemic.
That's what he said.
He says, you have my blessing. He says, some may choose to fight you because they don't understand and think you're moving a landmark. He says, but this makes perfect sense. And you have not only my blessing, but the blessing of the presiding bishop. And the presiding bishop immediately saw it and it resonated with, again, the vision God had given him and where we must go. Again, brothers and sisters, it's just the scripture of God's word that's aligned around these core values that's gonna take our schools on Sunday, as taught in many cities, in many impoverished areas, bring us back to the forefront of our Christian assignment And that's building and advancing the kingdom of God.
Let's pause, Dr. Atkins, right there and insert this, because a lot of people may not be aware that the original Sunday school only used the Bible. But there was a wonderful man who we all had to learn in Bible Bowl named Father Christmas.
Yes, sir.
Father Christmas introduced quarterlies. And oh boy, it did not go over well. Tell us about that, sir.
All right. Father Frank Christmas in 1916, he tried to introduce the quarterly. And many of the members, they did disagree with him.
You mean the quarterlies that we use now?
Yes.
There was a problem once with us using quarterlies.
Right. Let me put it this way. They believed that the Church of God in Christ was a spirit-led church, a church that waits for the leadership of the Holy Spirit. And they questioned, though, how could one know what the Spirit wanted the saints to learn 3 or 4 months ahead of time? So despite this confrontation, Bishop Mason did not see anything wrong with having the quarterly publication. And it was at that time then that they came up with a motto, a child saved is a soul saved plus a life. And then they had another slogan, reaching the unreached and bringing them in.
Wow.
And so there was opposition. But as we see today, we are very active with quarterlies.
We are very active with quarterlies. Mr. President, why is change so hard? Or respond in your own way to Father Christmas's fight for quarterlies.
Thank you. Father Christmas understood something, that God is not trapped by time. God uses time, but he's not dependent upon it.
Yes, sir.
God sits in eternity, and he has decided the end from the beginning. So while we think God is going to do what he's going to do when tomorrow gets here, God has already gone ahead of tomorrow. So we'll think, well, we got to be instant, and to be instant meaning God's going to speak in the moment. No, God has already spoken into your tomorrow. He's already spoken into your last day on the planet. And so when you understand, when you get your theology right, you won't be trapped trying to put God in time and understand him from a time construct. You'll understand God exists in eternity. Glory to God. God is a spirit. And he can take anything and use it to get his glory. Can you see? And so as long as we are praying, we're giving thought as we write out quarterlies, as we write out lesson plans for what? The edification, the building up of the believer, God will use it and get the glory. And again, the quarterly doesn't limit the teacher. It's a guide. There have been times I've been teaching Sunday school and the prompting of the Spirit begins to lead you to go deeper in a particular area. Mm-hmm. Or to immediately deal with what? Under the core values, ministering to people, a need in that classroom that you have to minister to. And you begin to minister to that. But the quarterly helps the what? The teachers study in advance. It helps the students prepare in advance. And it helps even the superintendent plan out how to build community, how to build the response around looking at these 12 to 13 expository lessons that are coming. This is why we must place a greater expectation upon our publishing house to get the curriculum and the material out on time. That we need to look at the material in advance as we plan in excellence. So if my brothers and sisters from the publishing house are watching, we plead with you, whatever it takes, please ensure that our quarterlies arrive to the houses of God well in advance so we can do this work and do it with excellence, that God may be glorified and the people edified.
Please, if you will, use September and October as an example, because beginning on this Sunday, We are in Genesis for 8 straight weeks. So as a teacher, if I know that I am in one book for 8 straight weeks, what advice do you have for me to prepare as I'm meditating, praying, knowing that we have this consecutive lessons? President.
Is that a question for me?
Absolutely. How should I prepare? How would you prepare knowing that you got 8 straight lessons in one book?
Well, you know, that's exciting because you don't have to move so quickly into another frame of thought. You can give more time to meditation on the quarterly, but you also can do more research around the principle in the scripture that God wants brought out, right? You can plan as it relates to the challenge or the expectation you want to set for the students. By the end of these 8 lessons, or by the end of these 12 lessons, we expect to see not only a greater comprehension of the scripture, but a greater practice of it. So again, as knowledge is progressive, so must practice be progressive. Mm-hmm. Can you see? We must become better. We must grow in the things of God. The Bible says, add to your faith knowledge. Knowledge. A practical working knowledge. Are you with me? That leads to the fulfillment of scripture. So you get better time for meditation, better time for planning, setting expectation. And then also remember, when it comes to teaching or leading, people respect what you inspect. And so all teachers and superintendents should have a time of inspection where we're asking, what are the disciplines you all are practicing this quarterly? What could we say we have done to add to the overall growth of the church, or our touch and or our reach into the community? And what are the testimonies behind this? You get to plan all of that when you stay in a subject matter or stay in a theme for any length of time. I hope this helps.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you, sir. Let's move to our next. We did. Let's move to our next. Responsive reading. I think we're coming down to my favorite one. Body. For as the body is one and have many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. You've heard tonight comments made about the various gifts. No one has all the gifts. Saints of God, we need one another. We need Dr. Atkins.
Right.
We don't have that experience, that knowledge, the professor. We need Dr. Ellis with the creativity, the genius. One of the things that is causing us to struggle is how we don't appreciate the various gifts within the body. So a constant reminder that we have many members, but we all on the same team. It may look like sometime we are not, but we're supposed to be. We are supposed to be on the same team. Everybody's voice must be heard. Thank you, Sister McClain. Please, if you will, put in the chat. Again, we're connecting it to the core values. Superintendent David Crawley beat me to it. He is the superintendent at our President's Church, the United Christian Faith Ministries. He beat me to it, and he put in the simulating people. Sister Ray, yes, I need you. You need me. We are all part. That's not just a song. That ought to be a way of life. It ought to be our mantra. I'm going to skip to the next one unless our two professors want to respond. Again, see the connection. For as we have many members in one body, all the members have not the same office. I got to pause and let the president respond.
The same office.
Same office. Come on. It can't be but one president of the International Sunday School Department. That's your office. Come on, sir.
Think about what Paul is saying. Office. Office. Not all have the same office. Same assignment. Same spiritual DNA and jurisdiction. So I don't just need your hand, I need your gift.
That's it.
Right? I need your office. And we have to be careful in the church with promoting just faithfulness, because you can promote a person for being faithful, but you can promote them to that level of incompetence. Because I'm promoting you to a position that you don't have the spiritual office for.
Wow.
And so Sunday school has to correct the misalignment that sometimes takes place in our churches. We just find a faithful person and say, God can use anybody. But can I tell you, he won't use you if he didn't design you that way. It's called abuse. God will only use you how he designed you. Can he grace you for a season? Give you a special anointing to do a gift? But just because man lays his hands on you does not mean God has laid his hands on you. This is why Paul told Timothy, lay hands suddenly on no man. Nobody. You must see if God has laid hands on first. I can only affirm what God has affirmed. Can you see?
My God.
We all have not the same office. This is why there must be a time of prayer. We can't just do favors in the church. I can't just because I like you, promote you. Because you have my back, I'm gonna put you in a place of incompetence. And so now abuse takes over. You're operating in an area that you don't have a grace to operate. And so then you become insecure when another anointing shows up that you don't have. And so now manipulation and control takes place. Office is not appointment here.
Wow.
It is within the body of Christ, the context of how each gift supplies the next gift. And we can be malnourished if we don't get the assignments of office is right. I'll leave it at that.
Repeating that same one, for as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. Please take the flow. Notice the flow. Next, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. I'm going to couple that, then pause. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Dr. Ellis?
Of course, that's the core value of building relationships. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. They know how much you care. Sunday school should be given to care and compassion, building new relationships. Schools on Sunday should at times pause and say, who should we go and touch? Is it orphanage kids? Some Sunday school teachers, and maybe it's a high school, a young adult, just say, let's go out and prepare kits for kids in orphanages. Or this Christmas, what can we do for some of the elderly in the nursing home? Let's connect to new communities. Maybe it's our school on Sunday adopts a school on Monday, mm-hmm. the Adopt a School Initiative. Or maybe we're passionate about a community that has been left out, marginalized, can't get their needs met, and thus we launch a Biblical Justice Initiative.
Come on.
That connects us to a community that feels left out and marginalized, building new relationships. Hallelujah. We're the light of the world.
Yes.
Not just our little church, not just our denomination, not just our district, but the world. And yeah. School pushes people, glory to God, to be in the world, but not of it. Sanctification is separation, but not isolation.
Yes, sir. And our last one, for those of us that are really Church of God, this is our last one for those that grew up, let me say it that way, that grew up, Dr. Atkins, you recognize this from our work. That's what I love about the responsive reading. You see Sunday school, evangelism, missions,
yes, sir,
music. We had to learn this one in YPWW, not the youth department, but in YPWW, but growing grace. Second Peter 3:18. This is how we end. But grow in grace.
Yes.
Grow. Be nice to people. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. That's how we end the responsive reading. I absolutely love this. I applaud the vision and the anointing for Christian education on our president. If would you like to respond to that last one as we get ready to close? Don't go nowhere if you're watching, because we're going to show you how to get all these slides that you've seen. We're going to show you how to access them, Mr. President.
Well, you know, the purpose of history is to teach us morality. And God has five orders: the moral order, the social order, the domestic order, the economic order, and the spiritual order. Our historian has put together an incredible historical narrative concerning Sunday school. And I want to make sure, Dr. Atkins, that that book is heavily published if we have to make some investments. I do know that's in your library. How can people get that book? Is it still in print? Can we produce more? Because part of growth is knowing your history. Part of growing in our moral obligation, our spiritual obligation, is knowing the history, the history of the church, the heritage of the church. Are you with me? And I'm speaking to Sunday school superintendents and teachers now. There's something very special about the Church of God in Christ Sunday School Department. When you see the pioneers, the laborers that God have appointed to lead this charge, I'm just so honored to be eighth in succession when it comes to superintendents who've led the charge. But again, the commentary and some of the information you've shared tonight, Superintendent Atkins, speak to that, and then I'll come back.
Yes, Dr. Ellis, let us get together, and from the Sunday School Department, let's go ahead and get volumes and volumes of it published. Awesome. So we can get together immediately and come up with a plan.
Absolutely. I would love to provide that. It will be one of many commentaries and historical narratives and just Christian literature that we will have in the library, and even maybe offer it through our Kojic bookstores there in Memphis, Tennessee as well. The infrastructure of the church is incredible. Great leaders throughout this church. I just pray that those who are called to school on Sunday, Sunday school, will continue to grow. And it's as leaders grow, we must be willing to embrace the teaching, the anointing in someone else's life. As Bishop Porter would say, you got to see the God in somebody else besides just yourself. And so there's programs out there for teachers to grow in grace. There's TIAC for Sunday school superintendents to grow in their leadership. There's LEAP. Are you with me? For activists and people who want to serve the community, there's the Biblical Justice Initiative that's coming out and will be launched in the international convocation this year in Memphis, Tennessee. Just some exciting things taking place in the Sunday school department. We're going to be talking about setting educational objectives for churches, and something we've missed as pastors and leaders in the last half of the 20th century, but how we can close that gap. We're going to be talking about these things and more as we all make a concerted effort to grow. I'll close with this. There's no real sustainable growth without feedback. And so I'm willing to be a vulnerable superintendent and get feedback from not only my peers, those who I serve alongside, the incredible minds. I'm not the smartest person on this team. As you can see, we have several offices on this team that make up the Sunday School Department. Our saintly supervisor and international field representative,
yes, sir,
Mother Penix, is another historian, a laborer, a woman that loves God, given to prayer. We're just so blessed to have a stellar team that helps us continue to grow and to come up with new ideas. We're open to new ideas. We're open to making a differential investment, so all of our Sunday schools can do that, grow and glow. And I pray that you will continue to be a part of what God is at work doing.
Now you all see why we are so excited in the International Sunday School Department God has greatly blessed us with such a fantastic leader. He's blessed us with Dr. Rodney Atkins. President Ellis, if you think that this is just talk, go ahead and travel on down to Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and you will see one of the greatest Sunday schools in the world. This is how he developed his church, and God has greatly blessed him, and we are so honored to have the opportunity to serve with such greatness in both of these men. You heard him talk about LEAP. It is our second class that the International Sunday School Department has released. You can have the opportunity to join the next cohort for LEAP. Let me remove this banner. LEAP is worth way more than $159, but I promise you, you're going to be blessed by it. You'll be able to register for the next LEAP in the next couple of days. You also can register for the next TAC course. And as I'm talking, I am searching through the slides. Sister Cox, who is working backstage also, you may have it more readily available. I thought I had all of them, but the next TAC course is going to start December the 5th.
Right.
And you can have that opportunity to join LEAP TAC Sunday School Department. There it is. Thank you, ma'am. TAC 5 is going to start December the 2nd. There are so many students in the chat that have gone through both. Some are in LEAP now. Dr. Virginia Jameson went through TAC, and now she is in LEAP. One of our star students, Sister Angela Madison, has gone through TAC and is now doing LEAP. Dr. Connie Compton serves as an academic advisor for TAC. She has gone through TAC. Many of you have commented in the chat talking about TAC and LEAP, and listen, it will be absolutely amazing. Superintendent Renee Jones, Memphis, is in TAC 4 right now. These are the visionary programs through meditation from the Lord that God has given. So to stay connected to us, this is what you need to do. Text LEARNING to 225-230-5683. You're going to give us your email, name, not a whole lot of information, but we need it so that we can send to you all of these wonderful programs that are being rolled out by the Sunday School. The president's vision is for us to pour into the local church, not to glean from the local church, but to pour, to build the local church, which in turn will build our International Sunday School Department. Thank you for staying to the end, because now you get an opportunity to see how you can share these slides. Sister Michelle Cox is our marketing and branding director, and she put an excellent idea into the chat. Share this video with your pastor, with your Sunday school teams, your churches, to help them understand why the shift to the new responsive reading has taken place. And if Sister Michelle, if you will load the QR code, go ahead and get your phone. I know, saints, you tired of this technology, but it ain't going nowhere. And what you need to do now is take your phone. Wait a minute, I clicked off on it, trying to move this banner. Take your phone. You're not going to take a picture. You're going to use your camera. Zoom in to that box that you see in the middle, and she has prepared where you can download all of these graphics that you saw on today. We'll give you a minute. We are looking for those that want to partner with the Sunday School. President makes you just want to give, and we do have a slide to give on tonight. If you want to give to the International Sunday School Department, we can show you how to do that. When I tell you it's a worthwhile investment to partner with this department, this visionary leader. But if you will, go ahead. We'll also let you know when you text LEARNING how you can give. There is a tip. Save this to your phone. Click click and hold the QR code and you'll be redirected to the responsive reading downloads. That is a tip on how to utilize this. We are going to make this video, is already public. We can download it where you can share it. You can send it to somebody else who got questions on the responsive reading. Maybe we can do this again in October with Dr. Atkins and our president so that we can continue to let you all know what this movement and this assignment is all about. But hopefully you have scanned this QR code so that you can get all of the slides that you saw tonight. If you did not get it, it's okay. You just have to watch this again. Go to our social media pages at Kojic ISSD. Follow our YouTube, our Facebook page. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. No cost. It's just helping you to keep up with all of the things that we are doing in this digital space that God has blessed us with. Thank you so much, Sister Michelle. These are the slides that you will see. You can have these up in your churches. You can give these to your media team so that while we are reading the responsive reading, you can read along with us. You can also have these playing at interludes within your service, at the end of the service, at the beginning, as people are gathering. You can print them out, some churches, and that's what we're going to do after this, share online what some of the churches did today, where they made posters, bookmarks. Some churches took their young people outside. Some churches are using the responsive reading to develop a missions program. So every week, they're going to use one of the responsive readings. How can we take but growing grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior and develop a program? Saturday, we're going to all come and we're going to start a book club because we are growing in the knowledge of our Lord. Look not every man on his own things. So on Friday, we're going to go and we're going to bless those that are homeless. I started to say something, but I better not. We're going to take each one of these slides. Don't forget to do good and let it be a lifestyle, right, and not just a responsive reading. The word of God should drive the things that we do in life. And it has been an honor to share these with you. These are already sized to fit the screens at your churches. So we're helping you take the work out of the presentation that you can share these and we can all grow together. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Dr. Rodney Atkins, you brought such a powerful aspect,
right,
to this presentation with the history. We honor you, sir. And we'll give our president closing remarks, but then ask our Dr. Atkins to pray us out. So first, Mr. President, and then our VP Atkins.
Again, thank you, Elder Payton, your incredible leadership and the team on the learning and development side, our marketing director, Sister Michelle Cox, thank you for your leadership as well. I just want to say as a prayer, my thoughts, I want everybody to be reminded that it is the Holy Spirit's job to keep us. And all I say tonight is be willing to be kept. Stay within the keeping power of the Holy Spirit. Why? We all got work to do. And keeping is a benefit of service. The Holy Spirit will keep you in perfect peace. He will keep you from falling if you stay in service. We all want benefits, but I don't know any company that gives you benefits if you don't work for it. You don't get the benefits of being kept if you don't serve. And remember, teachers and superintendents and students who are giving to the Lord's service, all of our work is warfare. But as it is with the Holy Spirit, his weapon of choice is the word of God. That's why we all have job security. It's so incredible, this work that we do with the word of God and teaching and instructing and the didactic and the pedagogy of instruction and the word of God. It is our weapon of choice. Stay in the warfare. and use the weapon of choice, which is the word of God, and you will always, always overcome. Thanks be unto God who giveth us the victory. And I'm excited because there are some incredible things coming with Sunday school. I'm excited. There's some incredible partnerships. I prophesy we're going to have corporate partners on the private sector side help to underwrite some of this national work. And you're going to see a department within the Church of God in Christ unlike any other department. Well taken care of because of the value of this work. Sunday school, I see you in the future. And we're looking even better than we do now. Thank you again, and God bless you. Superintendent Atkins.
Gracious God, we thank you, O Lord, for this session tonight. We thank you, O Lord, for the leadership of Dr. Ellis. We thank you, O Lord, for the vision that you have given him. And we thank you, O Lord, for the team, the vice presidents, the international field rep, the assistants. We thank you, Lord, for the Sunday school department. We thank you, Lord, for your precious people who came to listen tonight and to be informed. So I'm asking you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, continue to bless this work. Let your work multiply. Let it enlarge throughout the entire world. Let us reach souls for your kingdom. Let your people be inspired to seek after you through your word and to learn more of you, and help us to bear fruit in this hour. Continue to bless, O Lord, your people and in their labor and in their efforts, and continue to bless Dr. Mark Ellis. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Shalom.